everybody, and welcome. It's Catherine from Jane Catherine and Books, and I've been putting off filming this video because we've had awful dark weather here in the northeast, and it's not getting any brighter as the days are going on, so just have to go along with it really. So I'm going to be giving you a review of all the books that I've reviewed for publishers and via NetGalley. I'm going to be quite brief on each. There's a full review on my Goodreads account, Jane Catherine Pinkett, and I'd be here all day if I gave a big long spiel about everything. So here we go. Slurp of tea ready. Okay, the first one is Pachinko. This is by Min Jin Lee. It's published by Apollo. Now, its date for publication the 7th of February, but I do believe here in the UK it's been put off to the 10th of August. So I think probably you have to get that from the States if you want it before then. I think it was going to come out all on the same day, but I can't find any more out. This is a really good family saga. It's a historical fiction. It's based in Korea and in Japan, and we've got a young girl who, I'm trying to think of her name now, Sunja is the main female character, and she's disgraced her family really. She's become pregnant to an older man who turns out it's married, and this would be a big disgrace for the family. And to ease with things, we've got a passing parson from Japan that has offered to marry her and take her back over to Japan and save the family's face, as it were. This is a lovely family saga. It gives you a really good insight into the cultures of both Japan and Korea, so if that's your bag, you'll find that interesting. The characters were well developed. It was easy to read. It's quite a bit of a chunker, this one, but I did find that it was easy to read. I gave it 4 stars. The only reason I didn't give it 5 is that I felt that the last third of the book, there was so much crammed in, as if they were trying to get it in before the end. I personally would have preferred it as a duology and spaced that out a bit. But yes, well worth a read if you like your family sagas, interested in Korea and Japan. Next, Mother's Reckoning, C. Klebold. This is by, I'm just trying to see now, W.H. Allen are the publishers. This is out now. And this is the mother's story from the Columbine murders about 15 years ago, I believe now, over in America, in a school in Columbine. And this is a fantastic book. You know, it's taken a lot of guts to write this, and what I do like about it is she's making no excuses. Her son Dylan was one of the killers. She makes no excuses for that. She also sees the perspective of both her family's side, not knowing that their son was planning this, no signs of him planning this, and also she does have an understanding of the sides of the families of the victims as well. What I did like about it is that it drew you in. I could see both sides of the story, you know, being a mother of boys myself, and you could, you know, it's very well written, and I think this is why I overall gave it 5 stars. It's not just, oh yes, it's a very emotional subject, very heartfelt subject. That isn't the only reason I wanted to give it 5 stars. It is very well written. It's not just, oh, you know, a plain, flat, boring account of everything. They went through a lot. You know, they heard that this tragedy was going on. They were frightened for their son's life, like any parents whose kids went to school there, and suddenly have the FBI or whatever on the doorstep and ransacking the house, not telling them what's happening. And it turns out, you know, that their son was actually one of the perpetrators. Very heartfelt. also good has come out of bad. I think it's something that nobody that's involved in that would get over. But she did a lot of research into mental health. She's put difficult mental health issues on the map because it turns out that there was, you know, quite complicated mental health problems with her son that made him act this way. So, yes, well worth a read. Nice to see that perspective as well as, you know, the families of the victims. They had to get used to losing their son too. She was grieving the loss of her son and also loss of the son that she thought she knew. Every parent should read it. We think we know our kids, but do we really? So yes, well worth getting. Next, Painted Dragon. This is from Ergmont and it's a cosy crime children's book. This is by Catherine Woodfine. This is the third in a series in The Mystery of the Painted Dragon, its full title, and it's the Sinclair's Mysteries. And it's a great cosy crime for kids and any adults that like the cosy crime. It's a romp through historical Edwardian England. The historical content is very informative about the Edwardian times. It's not particularly a period of history that I know too much about. I know a lot more about Victoriana than the Edwardian times. It's got an art theme going through it, which has made it an interesting plot. I liked the characters. I thought the characters were well developed. I really liked those. Let's have a look at anything else that I've got on here that I've put on there that I'm missing out. Yeah, I mean, for anybody that loved, you know, Enid Blyton, I think this has just got a bit more of a tweak to it, which sort of brings it more up to date than Enid Blyton. And great cosy read for your kids. I'd like to go back and read book one and two. So, well worth getting, Painted Dragon. So next, we've got The Doll Funeral. This is Kate Hamer. This is by Ruby Shadow. And five-star read for me. Brilliant, I loved it. I liked her first book, The Girl in the Red Coat. This is even better. You can see that the writing and the plot is more intricate. There's some beautiful writing in this. This is about, we've got our main female character in here called Ruby, and at the beginning of the book, on her 13th birthday, she's told by parents that actually she was adopted. And this has a profound effect on her. Not because she's sad that she's adopted, she's really pleased. There's a lot of abuse that goes on in this household. And, you know, she really thinks that if she goes and finds a real mother, she'll be able to escape from the abuse. There's a lot of twists and turns in this. She meets three characters that one of the boys she met at high school, and they sort of become involved in a subplot, as it were, and help her to find a real mother. Running alongside, so it's really in 1983, present day, and then also running alongside that, we've got the backstory of actually her real mother in 1970 when Ruby was born. Fantastic. It's a psychological thriller at its best, and I think well worth a read. Next, we've got The Girl in the Glass Tower. This is by Elizabeth Furmantle, and this is by Penguin UK, Michael Joseph. This comes out 9th of February, I believe, although I've got 25th of July down here, so that's relevant that I think there may be a slight delay with this. Now, Girl with the Glass Tower, let me just find my writing about this. It's historical fiction. I gave it 4 stars. It soon draws you into the intrigue of it all. This is based in Hardwick Hall in Derbyshire, and this is about the lesser known Lady Arabella Stuart in our period of history over here in the UK. She was destined to succeed Elizabeth I, and for her own safety they take her off to Hardwick Hall and keep her, a bit like house arrest really, to, supposedly to keep her safe. Now, I also really love this because we didn't live far away. When we lived in Nottinghamshire, we lived not that far away from Hardwick Hall. We used to go there quite often for walks. It's a lovely, lovely setting. And so I could imagine, you know, that just made it even more interesting for me. Now, running alongside this, we've got two storylines, really. So we've got Lady Arabella Stuart, and then alongside that, we've got Amy. I was just trying to think. So the second protagonist is Amy, and it's Amy's story. Now, she's been exiled from the court, and as we start to get towards the last sort of third of the book, then these stories become entwined, and the two narratives come together. And I thought that they were gelled together well. Sometimes you get it where you feel that it doesn't come together quite right. So well-written historical fiction. Nice to follow. I think it's not too intricate that anybody new to the genre of historical fiction. Some of them can be a bit heavy, but this I feel is great for people that are just starting. Elizabeth Freemantle's written loads and loads of books. She's a real craftswoman. I have read better, hence the 4 stars of hers. I didn't really like the characters, and I think that sort of took a bit of the edge off for me. She wasn't exactly the most endearing of people, this Lady Arabella, and you can understand why she hasn't always been the highest amongst the subjects to be written about, really, because horrible. But yes, well worth a read, 4 stars. Next, Paper Butterflies. This is by Lisa Heathfield. It's Egmont Publishing. This is a YA. Loved this, 5-star read. Beautifully written, very powerful, very heartbreaking at times. Raises quite a few important subjects. June, so we've got June. I'm just trying to think of a name. It's June, yes, definitely. She's the narrator, and she narrates this story through her eyes as a child and also as an adult. And she's got this stepmother who, a stepmother and a step siblings, really are quite abusive and awful to her, but nobody believes her. There's a lot of abuse going on. Her own father's so besotted with his new wife that he doesn't see what's going on. He disbelieves her. And I feel it highlights just how complex abuse is. It's not always quite straightforward. And I think that it is important for books like this to be written for young adults and, you know, that sort of age group to be reading and getting a fix on it. Love the friendship between June. She develops a friendship with somebody called Buster, and their characterizations are beautiful. I think they're really nicely developed, and you really feel this kinship with them, I think, really, which for me is important in a book. It gives it so much more enjoyment. Their journey was very emotional for me, and it still has long-standing effects. I think I'm still thinking about it now, which I think you would too. And I always think that's a sign of a really good book. So, yeah, and I think that it shows that despite adversity, we all need to have courage to fight against cruelty and injustice. And good comes through in the end. So please read that. Well worth its 5 stars. Next. Told you we've got loads. Local Girl Missing. This is by Claire Douglas. This is Penguin, again, Penguin UK, Michael Joseph. This is another 5-star read. And, you know, people that know me, I don't give 5 stars out easily. You know, I am prepared to give a lot less if I don't think they warrant it, but I've just happened to have some really brilliant reads and new publications. We've got some cracking stuff coming out. So, this is a psychological thriller. It's quite, you could just feel the atmosphere with this one. 21 years ago, Sophie goes missing. She lives in a seaside town, goes missing, presumed dead. And 21 years later, her best friend is contacted by Sophie's brother to let her know that a body, well, remains, not many remains, I wouldn't think, after 21 years, have been found, and that they are the remains of Sophie. And it seems from the coroner's report that it was an accidental death. She fell in the sea while drunk, that sort of story. But her brother doesn't believe it, and he's asked for Frankie's help. So there's alternating chapters here. So we get the story of Sophie, so her diary leading up to her disappearance and death, and also reading through some of the stories, etc., that she's written. And we then get Frankie's present day with her brother and how they're going to try and find out. So we get the two stories running alongside each other. When Frankie goes back to this place, all sorts of weird things keep happening. Somebody's trying to spook her and frighten her. So yes, very clearly written, very suspenseful, as I said. Quite a few red herrings in there so that you don't guess the ending. Slow burner to start with, so don't give up on it. And only important note, don't read the notes from the author at the end till you've read the book, because it spoils it. There's spoilers in there, so be warned. Cannot wait to read more of her work. Cracking read. Can't think what I was going to say then. Give it a try, please. And then a couple of just quick little bits. This is mainly out there for booktubers. I don't know if you know Buzz Publishers. BuzzPublishersMarketplace.com. They bring out spring and summer, autumn, winter. They bring out a catalogue that gives you a bit of a heads up about what's coming out, what you can request to review. So you can request that from NetGalley. It's well worth getting. It's really interesting. It gives you a heads up of the top, what they think will be the top sellers and prize winners. And then next we've got something called Journal Sparks. This is coming out in April by Emily J. Neuberger. Anybody that loves journaling and creative stuff, this is by Story Publishing. Very well written, lovely pages set out, ideas for doing crafts and your journals. I have requested they send me this in real format so I can show you, because I think with craft things, it's not easy to talk about them without showing them in the real person. So hopefully they'll send something and we can have a look at that. So thank you for joining me. It's been a bit of a mumble jumble video, but there's just so many to let you know about that, just a quick insight to some great titles that's coming up. Go to my Goodreads if you want to read about each one specifically. Thank you for joining me. I can finish my tea off now and take a big deep breath. Bye for now. Bye.